We now had a quorum at their scheduled meeting time. May we please invite the administration team into the room, please? The attendance list has been distributed to members prior. I will not go through them one by one. On the 24th, made a meeting that the subcommittee has completed discussion on the policy aspect and already started the class by class on LN66, and we shall start on part 8, section 81 of LN66. Can the administration continue to go through the class by class, and we invite the members for questions. And I will ask my colleague to continue with the class by class. At the last meeting, we completed a huge part of the bill. The remaining part is about an investigation, disciplinary action, and appeal, some kind of miscellaneous items. So we'll pick up where we left off and start from 67. That for the investigation based on the PAO, that for any follow-up disciplinary action, that the AFCA would deal with it based on the amended PAO. And second, on the immediate and secrecy provisions shall continue to apply for the pre-amended PAO. For section 69 onwards, it would deal with the disciplinary sanctions. And section 71, that the complaints not made but can be follow up due on the amended PAO, Professional Account Ordinance. That for the complaints that not yet dealt with the HKIPCA Council must deal with it by the ARFCA. That for any complaints due with the HKICA during the transition shall continue to dealt with by the HKICPA. For 73 to 75 for the pre-amended PAO, continue to apply to section 35.1 that for the discipline offenses that yet to take effect by the commencement date. And for 76 or 77, that for the pre-amended PAO, the disciplinary order, the taking effect and the effect of the final disciplinary order. For part 8 is about the transition and saving provisions in relation to appeal under the pre-amended PAO. For section 79, for the disciplinary committee decisions on the before the commencement date, in which the right to appeal to the court of appeal will be preserved. At 82 to 83, that the pre-amended PAO for any appeal that yet no final determination before the commencement date, they'll continue to deal with it in the pre-amended PAO. For part 9, that under the pre-amended PAO and the subsidiary legislation for the miscellaneous matters and the saving provisions. For section 84, that the pre-amended PAO, section 80B for directions given, for example, directing the accountant to show the registration or to withdraw any nullified certificates. That for the section 85 listed certificate under section 32 of the pre-amended PAO continues to apply. And section 86 and 87, that no application for restoration of name under section 39 bracket 1 of pre-amended PAO on after the transition date. And since the registration function has been transferred to AFRC, so this two parts no longer apply. For Section 88, Mr. Holden Chow. For Section 87, I have an inquiry. That pending application for restoration of name under Section 31(9) bracket 1 of the pre-amended PAO. Since I'm not too familiar with the restoration mechanism, on what basis does some of the accounting firm or entities or corporate or individuals that can restore their name under the register? Is that because they have been deregistered and somehow able to re-register them? I want to find out about Section 87. Deputy Secretary. For the accountancy registration, not just one's name can be removed besides disciplinary matters. For example, the accountant with the registered had passed away. Well, for quite some time, he or she had been out of, not been practicing in Hong Kong. Or there are a few ways of forming an accounting firm. And sometimes they may have a change of partnership. In these circumstances, the name of the certain firm may vanish in the register for a while. Let's say an accountant has been practicing under a certain name in Hong Kong to provide professional accounting services for the past few years. He or she may be in Canada or in the U.S. Then he or she returned to Hong Kong to practice. Therefore, he applied to restore his old name. So we deal with the under different circumstances that how to restore the name. Chairman, I hope you don't mind. Why I'm asking this, for Section 87, that before the transition date, there will be quite some time which allows some accountants can have their name restored before the transition date. According to Mr. Hui, maybe his or she moved to another jurisdiction and returned to Hong Kong and need to restore their name. Or maybe the company, the partnership was dissolved. I'm quite concerned that so when the AFRC is formed or before the transition time, there is still a last empty window period in which the HICPA can able to restore some firms. So maybe in this window period, they can restore a lot of firms. So after restoring the names, the HKISPCA can just inform the AFRC. So whatever decisions made by the HKISPCA, only notify the AFRC of the decisions. According to Mr. Hui, that's for restoration of the firm's name. It's really just because of moving to another jurisdiction, just some procedure matters, but not because of disciplinary matters, which can effectively allay my concerns. So maybe I would like to hear from MSTB. For any disciplinary related issues, and this company hope to be have their name restored, the way Section 87 is written would allow this firm to be restored in this empty period, or the AFRC can actually review this applications or the inclusion in the register. Thank you, Mr. Chow. So maybe the Deputy Secretary can respond that under the pre-amended PAO, that would any demands on those relevant matters. Mr. Chow's concern that before and after transition, the same will apply, that the qualifications of the accountants must be renewed every year. If an accountant will meet the qualification this year, and due to their own personal circumstances, either disciplinary or not, and for the next year, when they renew their registration, not able to meet the statutory requirement, then their license will not be renewed automatically. As for whether as there will be a last-minute rush before the transition date, this will not be the case. Under the new regime, the accountant need to renew their certificate, must reapply from the AFRC. Next, Ms. Doreen Kong. I would like to ask about the disciplinary procedures. Just now, the public officials went quite fast. There are over 40,000 members of the HKI's CBA. I'm supposed to have quite a number of complaints ongoing. And for subsection part 3, you talk about the disciplinary procedures. Okay, please correct me if I'm wrong. Let's say a complaint is ongoing. I know that it will be passed on. I think I'm referring to section 72. I think it's quite vague that the complaint submitted will be dealt by the pre-amended PAO, while the complaint will be scrutinized by the panel members. For the panel members, and would they be reappointed by the AFRC? If we don't make it clear enough, let's say an accountant, let's say he or she has a legal representative, that we need to start over the whole inquiry process. That would be a waste of time and resources. Besides Section 72 on the disciplinary matters during the transition period and any other section that actually deal with the discipline matters, I'm a professional myself. For lawyers, sometimes they need to apply for a proof of good standing, for example, not subject to any disciplinary action in the past. Under the new regime, let's say a listed company want to make sure the accountant had no disciplinary or ethics issues. For the new AFRC, let's say they want to ask for the record for the past 20 years. Is it okay they can just inquire the AFRC? Then the AFRC can provide the proof that whether they had any disciplinary record in the past. Administration. Thank you, Ms. Kong's question. The first question for the transitional period arrangements. For Section 72, so why we did not hand over the complaint to FRC? Let's say the complainant in the HKI CPA and at their own administrative procedure and workload considerations. Well, if the HKI CPA registrar has not yet submitted a complaint to the HKI CPA Council, in the course of dealing with the complaints, the procedure cited by Ms. Kong had yet to be commenced. And at that stage, it's just the staff from the HKIPCA just had a brief look. For this kind of complaints, they would hand over to the AFRC for handling, and the AFRC shall follow the FRCO. Would do with the complaints based on the statutory powers and issue any disciplinary direction?
If the ICPA has already started disciplinary procedures, then our handover will set up the committee, and when the procedures are complete, the case will be handed over to AFRC, and when the complaint investigation is underway, as explained before, when the disciplinary actions are handed down, it will be handed over to the AFRC and will be handled by them. Now, if the procedures in the ICPA, then the results of the disciplinary actions and the implementation, the authority will be handed over to the AFRC. So, for example, the decision might be to revoke their professional registration. Then AFRC, at that point, will take over the relevant authority powers. So the intention is to avoid the difficulty, as Ms. Gong mentioned, the HKICPA, the handling might be different, and the investigated party would have to arrange for a new disciplinary action or investigation. So at every critical stage, there will be only be one, either the Hong Kong ICPA or the AFRC, to handle the case. So that is the first issue. Your second question, the issue of good standing. When we handled the first subsidiary legislation, the commencement date, we had mentioned we need to deal with early commencement, and when AFRC arranges its regulatory functions, they need to collect information from Hong Kong ICPA. The registrar information, the data contained therein, well, all kinds of data will be involved. The reason for doing so is for AFRC, they need to decide whether to issue professional registrations status. They have to consider whether the application is fit and proper, whether they comply with the two pieces of legislation. The accounting and financial reporting ordinance and so on. So that might affect the professional standing, whether they are fit and proper, and any background information. The AFRC needs to have to possess that information. And if that application, they have previous misconduct, that would affect their professional standing, then the AFRC, whether they will continue to issue a registration, that is the information they need to consider. So AFRC will grasp this information. So that means from now on, if I want to ask whether an accountant, whether their behavior, might have been an accountant for a long time. If I'm a company, I wish to collect this information, I just need to go to the AFRC. It depends on two situations. If the accountant is a practicing accountant, the registration information will be held by AFRC. So all the professional registration, will I be able to check his previous conduct? So a lawyer's previous background can be discovered because the law society will disclose such information. So AFRC, will they be privy to that information or to previous information? Because a company, they have, in the past, they could ask the Hong Kong ICPA, and now I should ask the AFRC. So that means the Hong Kong ICPA will have to keep all the records. So the second condition that I was referring to, if it is not a practicing accountant, if they just a professional accountant but not practicing, that registration information is still held by Hong Kong ICPA. They will still maintain the personal information of a professional accountant. So a practitioner, if you want to look up their historical data of good standing, then you have to go to AFRC. It's a one-stop service. For a professional accountant, you'll have to check with Hong Kong ICPA. So AFRC and Hong Kong ICPA, that personal information, so the relevant information regarding a practicing accountant, we have authorized AFRC to collect that information from Hong Kong ICPA. So does all personal information, does AFRC maintain all that information? No, because they would have to consult Hong Kong ICPA. They might have to look up the training information and other information. But for practicing information and professional and even disciplinary action, that information is within the AFRC system. I have a small comment. I want to express the opinion that the computer information has to be transferred efficiently. We're concerned that it is not maintained efficiently. You have to ensure that for a practicing accountant, that information has to be in the computer files, because accuracy is paramount. The second, thank you for talking about the difference between practicing and professional status. The public might not be that aware. So when the law is enacted, we have to convey to the public very clearly. So in the past, I wouldn't know that there was such a difference, honestly speaking. So in the future, I hope you can provide more information to the public. Otherwise, we would not grasp the full picture. Thank you, Ms. Gong Yuk-Fun, for your opinion. I think the officials have taken notice that they would have to conduct more public education. Please continue with clause by clause. And just now, we were at Division 9, so clause 88. According to Section 49, if they wish to withdraw, they'll have to do so accordingly. So we also have 34 bracket 1, the complaints. That is because the ICPA, after the transition, they will still deal with complaints. QP students, we will maintain this legislation such that they can, so that they can deal with that. Now, part 10 is miscellaneous matters in relation to the ordinance, including practice irregularity committed before transition date. So this section applies in relation to any practice irregularity, and so this refers to misconduct, including PIE, accountants, auditors, and 90 bracket 1 applies to a practice irregularity before the transition date. And that was the original FCR 37A. The regularity regarding PIE. So now we'll have to define that as accounting and financial reporting irregularity. Yeah. So moving on, this is a technical amendment because on the last meeting we mentioned that regarding the consultation committee, it will take effect in July. During the transition date between July and October, the FCR has not changed its name. So in 92A, it refers to FCR. We have to clarify that the reference to AFRC is referring to the FRC. Now, Section 93, AFRC's powers to give directions to relevant persons. It refers to the relevant documents and information, and I'll call Section 94. Ms. Gong-Fun, thank you, Chairman. Clause 93, Section 93, AFC's powers to give directions to relevant person. What person, who are you referring to? 93 bracket 2 states that the person whose registration as a certified public accountant ceased to be valid. So those are the persons that are being referred to. So it's just the accountant, not the other people. Yes. Well, if 93 is contravened, so that's a professional misconduct. There are no other penalties. Is that the case? It's quite... there are a lot of details I'm wary that I might have misunderstood. Well, we're talking about tens of thousands of people and some not in Hong Kong. What if there's no non-compliance? Any response? We need some time, Chairman. If they need time, they can reply on the next occasion. We are referring to accountants who are not professionally registered, so penalties targeting them might not be applicable. The maximum penalty would be not being able to register as a professional accountant. So as Ms. Gong-Fun said, we can submit the information on the next occasion. Well, if they cannot become a professional accountant, you have to spell that out. Because a lot of people have emigrated, are not in Hong Kong, so this is important, Chairman. Okay, so officials can supplement the information subsequently. Moving on. Section 94 is a saving section of 50C, and Schedule 10 to pre-amended ordinance. So before the transition date, the ICPA specified on Section 50C of the pre-amended ordinance, the way which and the time within which a PIE item must pay levy. Section 95, saving of Section 52 of pre-amended ordinance. So this section applies in relation to the proceedings referred to in Section 52.1 of the pre-amended ordinance that commenced before the transition date. Section 52 of the pre-amended ordinance continues to apply on and after the transition date in relation to proceedings. Section 96, application of Section 55 of amended ordinance. So after Section 55 of the amended ordinance does not apply in relation. Section 97, saving of 2019 pre-amended ordinance in relation to certain investigations, because in 2019 we had made an amendment to AFRC ordinance. So any auditing or when pre-amendments, the investigation can, according to part three of the preparation of the specified rule, can commence. Now, section 98.
So section 98, well, the HKICPA provide records and assistance to the AFCA with record and assistance to help the AFCA with the transition arrangements. So that's conclude the scrutiny of part 10. Mr. Holden Chow. Thank you, Chairman. For section 98, well, they list out the kind of assistance and records that the HKICAPA must provide to the AFRC, and as well that it will be provided to the AFCA within a designated period. I'm not sure if I missed anything. If the HKSB accounts fail to comply, then who or which entity should be held accountable? I don't think it's expressed in the provision. I wonder if it appears elsewhere. So what is the consequence of non-compliance, or who should be held accountable? For the transfer of information, well, it's about jurisdiction-related information or records. Well, in terms of the legal relationship between the FRC and the HKSPCA, the former is the supervisory agency of the ICPA. Then on the FRCO, that we do have provisions on the regulatory powers of the FRC. Where it sees necessary, it can issue written instruction to the HKSPA. It's provided in the law that the HKSPA must comply with these kind of directions. Otherwise, it will be in breach of the FRCO. So the supervisory power or regulatory power is the basis. And then part 11 is other consequential amendment. Since we talk about a lot of the legal provisions, I suppose that we can include them as two categories. After we amended the FRCO, when FRCO is invoked elsewhere, for example, in companies winding up in miscellaneous provision ordinance and Cap 32, as well as company forms regulations, Cap 32 sub-legis B, when it's referenced in other legislation, that the FRCO ordinance will be substituted with Accounting and Financial Reporting Council Ordinance, AFRCO. And for example, definition of auditors, that actually the definition is up from the PAO applies after we enacted the AFRCO. For any reference of the accountant and auditors will be changed or substituted to a pre-amended a professional accountant's ordinance. Since it's all repetitive and involve a different ordinances, that's all set up in part 11, and we are not going to go through them one by one. Do members have any views or questions? Chairman. For the council to pass this resolution with so much consequential amendments, so a deal will be enacted the same time of passage, since we're talking about so many pieces of legislation involved. Besides the parts that will be commenced in advance on the 4th of July, the other kind of amendments will take effect concurrently on the 1st of October. Any other views and questions from members? May I ask the legal advisor, does she have any questions regarding the legal or the drafting aspects? So members have just scrutinized the Chinese and English, the Chinese version of the markup copies, and there's no discrepancy compared to the English version. We do have the LN 6667 about the amendment of Schedule 3B. Actually, this is the Accountant and Financial Reporting Council Ordinance Amendment of Schedule 3B. When the functions of the ICPA transfer to AFRC, that the first year of the levies will be exempted. And for 3B, amendment of Schedule 3B, the 1 year into the operation for the new regime, as the government has promised that the fees will be set at the same level before the transition. For the kinds of fees covered, for example, the issue of practicing certificate, the issue of a renewed practicing certificate, and application renewal registration of a firm name or a firm, as well as application or renewal or registration as a corporate practice under Section 38A. As well, renewal or registration firm name for aim or firm. That's about which is this all this amendment is all about. Any questions, Mr. Nelson, Dr. Professor Nelson Lam? So you raise fees in the future, that means you have to amend the notice as well. For any changes to the AFRC charges and all the statutory charges all regulated in the ordinance, and for any future hikes, you need to come back to LegCo. Any other questions? And that's about it. Well, it's a good thing because it's not just the Hong Kong ICPA Council decides. This will be subject to the LegCo scrutiny in the future. Ms. Kong? So, speaking of the consequential amendments of so many legislations, this actually affects a lot of different entities. Even though it is just the amendments are minor, I hope the administration, besides stepping up public education, I wonder if you can write to the relevant organizations or departments notifying them. As this will affect the drafting of certain kind of documents. Well, like say the general public or those working organizations, they're not listen to LegCo meetings or pay close attention to the Gazettes. I hope that you can notify the organizations and the government departments. So Ms. Kong's suggestion had a point. I hope that you can write to the organizations affected by the amendments to notify them about the changes or the updates to the ordinance references. Any other questions and views? The supplementary information provided by administration. On the 24th of May meeting, the subcommittee urged the administration to provide supplementary information in regards to the advisory committee under the new accountancy regulatory regime. The supplementary information has been issued to members on 26th of May through CB paper bracket 1308/2022. And do members have any questions in regard to the administration follow-up? If not, okay, legislative timetable. I will move a motion on the 1st of June Legal Council meeting to extend the scrutiny period of the three pieces of subsidiary legislation to 29th of June, and our report on the deliberations at the House Committee on the 17th of June. And for the deadline to move amendment on these subsidiary legislations will be 22nd of June 2022. Any other business? Any other business under AOB? If not, I have a question for the administration. Well, for the termination of the qualifications recognition between Hong Kong and in the US, now that we're transferring the registration powers to the FRC, may I ask the administration for the agreements, the mutual agreements signed by the or reciprocal agreements signed by the HKICPA, how will they be transitioned to the AFRC? When last week in the community there was some heated debate and some blame this new regulatory regime. I have clarified in the media. What is the AFRC take on this or any impact, as we have heard from adequate clarification from the government? Thank you, the chairman, for giving me time to elaborate. As the public may not be too familiar with the registration mechanism, the reciprocal or mutual agreement between Hong Kong and the U.S. doesn't mean that there are any problems on this standard of accountancy, that we both follow different international standards to build up our profession. Like other professional services, if the professionals in one jurisdiction to provide professional services elsewhere, there are other additional requirements besides the professional qualifications, just like a foreign trained doctor cannot just start a business in Hong Kong right away. That's about the bilateral recognition by professional bodies. As for the reciprocal agreements between Hong Kong and the U.S., well, actually, not just about the USA, in terms of the mutual recognition. And for those coming to Hong Kong to provide professional accountancy services, they actually need to have a local practicing experience before gaining full exemption and have their overseas qualifications recognized in Hong Kong to provide professional accountancy services. We found out from the HKICPA that this part, the USA makes some additional requirements which the HKICPA cannot accept, which led to the discontinuation of this agreement. However, there's no correlation to the standard of accountants, that the, let's say, an accountancy in the U.S. and in Hong Kong, they would need to satisfy additional requirements before providing the services. What are the qualifications recognition? What is the relation with the AFRC? When the AFRC decides whether a professional accountant can practice, the is just one factor for consideration, in which, as a professional accountant, whether it is benefiting from any mutual agreements signed between Hong Kong and other jurisdictions, that the agreement between the U.S. and Hong Kong will let the AFRC consider as one of the factors on whether to issue practicing certificate to those accountants concerned. In terms of qualifications recognition between Hong Kong and other jurisdictions, the AFRC had a statutory interest. Of course, they hope the bilateral recognition
can be more mature, which facilitate exchange among professionals. At the same time, the FRC also respect
So when overseas practitioners wish to practice in Hong Kong, they have their own requirements. So the AFRC is aware of these considerations. So that would conclude my elaboration. Thank you for the clarification, Mr. Lam Jiyun. I also wish to thank the Undersecretary for the clarification. I believe the public needs to understand that the so-called professionals, this is profound information, otherwise it wouldn't be considered professional. So Chairman and I are professional accountants. Deputy Secretary Mr. Hui is also very familiar with our industry. So the KOL, they don't understand our industry and make comments that would just lead to confusion. So I'd like to thank the Secretary for giving us clear explanation. So I'd like to take this opportunity to explain. Accountants, there are practicing and non-practicing accountants. And today, or in the last few meetings, we are talking about practicing accountants. So when that authority is handled by the AFRC, it will not affect our previous agreements. So if you look at Hong Kong ICPA and the agreement that will expire at the end of the year, these are all fair, all 11 of them are fair, reasonable, and legal. So why does this issue occur? I believe it is because there's a change in the US standards. They require other mutual recognition agreements to change. So I am a representative of this industry because I have taken the uniform CPA exam, or that is the US exam. Now, I said that American standards are changing very quickly. We are talking about a 20-year industry, 20-year history. They are not separating practicing and non-practicing accounts, but that the U.S. is the only jurisdiction that is doing so. And they will say that if the U.S. changes, you have to comply with us, and otherwise we won't recognize you. So it's very unfortunate that some people in Hong Kong, they don't understand the background. They don't understand the professional development across the world. And they think that mutual qualification recognition, industry standards are falling. And so, well, these people need to brush up their knowledge first. Well, if they don't wish to brush up their knowledge, so they can communicate with the chairman and myself. They can try to understand the professional accounting industry development. So they don't need to be afraid. If there's any fear, it affect financial stability and overall stability. So these are very small issues, but have profound impact. We need stability, we need knowledge, we need professionalism. Thank you for the government, thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Lam Jiyun's views. Mr. Lam Jiyun and myself have tried to explain the situation in different venues. I believe the government, if there's any further development, they will also make clarifications. So do members have any other issues they wish to raise, any AOB? If not, then I announce the meeting adjourned. Thank you for attending. Thank you.